It's from the Holy Gospel according to the Evangelist St. Mark.
Glory to thee, O Lord.
Glory to thee.
At that time, Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly unto Pilate, and craved the body of Jesus. And Pilate marveled if he were already dead. And calling unto him the centurion, he asked him whether he had been any while dead. And when they knew it of the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph, and he brought the fine linen, and took him down, and wrapped him in the linen, and laid him in a sepulchre which was hewn out of a rock, and rolled a stone unto the door of the sepulchre. And Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of Joseph, behold where he was laid. And when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, had brought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came into the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said unto themselves, Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he said unto them, Be not affrighted, ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen, he is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. But go your way, tell his disciples and Peter, that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him, as he said unto you. And they went out quickly, and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled and were amazed, neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid.
Glory to thee, O Lord, glory to thee.
Please be seated. Welcome on this Sunday of the Holy Myrrhbearers and St. Joseph of Arimathea. I think we live in a world today that is very cold to Christ. And one of the things that I see in our world, perhaps even in myself, is this coldness manifested, this lack of love manifested in a way that's reflected upon our two lessons today. There's words that have seemed to have fallen into disrepair, to disrepute, to lack of use, and to total ignorance. Words like love, yes, but words like duty, like loyalty. Ultimately, the foundation of our church, practically speaking, is built precisely upon these types of words. Duty, loyalty, work even. And today as we study these lessons, we'll see these two words of loyalty and duty and reflected in love indeed laid before us for consideration. How love is performed is important. That love is performed is important. James said, Be ye a doer of the word, not a hearer only, deceiving yourself. You see, love, if it's real, comes out in some sort of manifestation. There's no substitute, my brothers and sisters, for plain old work, for duty, for labor in the church, and if we love God, for Him. And truly, it's these small acts of love that are performed by us that build a great building, the church, His body. And so, as we study today, these readings give this testimony to the reality of the fact that in the early church, men and women labored out of love for God, but they labored, whether they felt that love or not. And so we should consider this statement. When the feeling of love is cool, duty keeps the practice of love alive. Thus the flame of love captures and continues and burns even when the heat is small. What I mean by that is that when we do love, even when we don't feel it, we keep love alive, both in our hearts and in the world around us. And so, let's study these people today with the idea of applying to ourselves, how's our love quotient as reflected in our duty and our loyalty to the body of Christ. The apostles' ministry was certainly an important ministry. And we learn in our reading in the book of Acts that it was very important, so important that they couldn't leave the preaching and teaching of the Word of God, which had been bestowed upon them to carry the gospel forth by the Lord himself, to leave and to wait tables. And yet, we see in the appointing of people to wait on tables the truth of the church, that every job is important, and to every job there's a person if the church is going to be full. And so different people were assigned to perform different tasks by God. Preaching was needful. The apostles said, it's not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. So, what do we do? Preaching's needful. The apostles were gifted to preach. And oftentimes we talk about gifts here, that God's given each of us spiritual gifts and assignments that only we can complete. And if we don't complete them, they don't get done. To the detriment of the church, to the detriment of our own souls, to the detriment of those around us in our communities. So the apostles, realizing that preaching was important, didn't just say that the tables aren't going to get waited on. They signed seven men. This is how they did it. They said to the brethren, look out among you, seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, that we may appoint them over this business. You see, even the job of the lack right below the apostolic ministry still required that people be honest, that they have character, that they be full of the Holy Ghost, and that they be full of wisdom. All the ministry that can be done, whether it's ordained ministry or not, requires that we be full of the Holy Spirit to do it, that we be honest, that we be full of wisdom. And so, deacons needed character. The same character that's in the priest, that's in the bishop, that was in the apostles. Deacons needed wisdom. They needed to be honest. And they needed to be full of the Holy Spirit to serve all. Serving God requires these characteristics. No matter how big or small we may deem our ministry to be, we are required to have the character, the same kind of character that was in the apostles. The apostle said here that all must pray. He said, but some must pray continuously. He said, we have to give ourselves continuously to prayer. That's not everyone's call. That's not everyone's gift. But to the apostles, it was required that they pray, that they teach, they seek the Holy Spirit and spread the gospel by word. So, prayer was important, but waiting on tables was important. And the same that we select people out to wait on tables met with great applause by the multitude. And so they chose out seven men, and they set them aside, Stephen, Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch, and set them aside, and laid hands on them, and prayed, and the Holy Spirit filled them to do the first work of the deacons in the church. This was the beginning of the diaconal ministry, to wait on tables. And when I think about the waiting on tables, I think about what the deacons do today. Not only do they wait on the physical tables and the meals, and carry food and do good things to people in the community, but they wait at the holy table. And so it was that in the first ministry there was the seeds of that truth, that the deacons would serve at the holy table, at the altar, at the table of proskuneum, that they'd carry the gifts to the community and wait on tables in a way that was both spiritual as well as physical. Ordinations were performed. Ordinations are still performed. Men are ordained to particular ministries in the church. Men are elevated to the diaconate, to the priesthood, the episcopacy, even to the patriarchal sees. They are set apart by this laying on of hands, this apostolic succession, this ministry that's specially ordained. But my brothers and sisters, there's other ministries that require spiritual people.
that are not ordained specifically by a special ceremony of laying on of hands. And if you think about the church, think of all the ministries that are required for the church to function. People need to pray. People need to set up. People need to cook. People need to visit each other. People need to help one another. People need to preach. People need to teach. People need to say the prayers. There's so many things, so many works. Some ordained, some not. But to the extent that we're filled with wisdom, that we're filled with the character of the apostles, that we're honest, that we have the Holy Ghost beside us, we can do these ministries. And when the properly functioning church, filled with the Holy Spirit, does its job, each and every one of us, then great things happen. It says the word of God increased at the end of the reading in Acts today. And the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly. And it says even a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. The ministries that God provides are multiplied, not just to specially ordained ministries. The work of the church is broad. Each one of us, whether we're ordained or not, has a work in the church. I spent 17 years as a reader. I wasn't ordained by anybody or was taunted, but I served to the best of my ability. And perhaps you're like that. You're not ordained. That doesn't mean you don't have a ministry. All it means is that if you're full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom and have the character that God wants you to have, then you will be able to minister exactly how God wants you to minister. And if in due time God ordains you specifically by the laying on of hands, so be it. And if he doesn't, also so be it. But the church requires each and every one of us to exercise the gifts that we have within the role that we're able to exercise in. And so God leaves us with a sense, after reading the Holy Book of Acts, that ordination is needed, yes, but unordained ministry is also important. People need to respond to the Word of God, and it's us as the body of Christ that present it to them. When we turn to the Gospel, we consider the events around the burial of Jesus and the appearance of the myrrh-bearing women, Joseph taking his body and laying it to the tomb. And we see souls serving God. They're serving from a lack of full knowledge. Why do I say that? Because they didn't know he was risen. Joseph of Arimathea, it says, was an honorable man, a counselor, man high in the hierarchy of the Jewish religion. And he waited for the kingdom of God. He was looking for Christ to be God. He was waiting for the kingdom of God to come among men. And when Jesus died, he was filled with sorrow, but he was filled with a sense of love for the man that he'd known, Jesus, for the one that he said was a rabbi, for the one that he loved. And he went to Pilate, a risky maneuver, and revealed himself as a follower of Jesus. And it says here that he craved the body of Jesus. Joseph had a love for Jesus. Joseph didn't know he'd arisen. He didn't have the ability that we have to look back in history and see the risen Christ, to have the Holy Spirit confirm in us the truth of the resurrection. He simply loved Jesus, and he wanted to pay respect to the body of Jesus. He craved a decent burial for the Lord. Even without knowing the full story, he went at risk to himself, and he went before Pilate and asked for the body of Christ. Do we crave the body of Christ? I thought to myself as I read this, that the body of Christ, as the apostles say, is the church. Do I crave what I can touch of Christ in this world, which is my brothers and sisters assembled in the church? Do I crave him that way? Am I willing to go before Pilate and ask for his body that I might wrap it, that I might honor it, that I might do good to it? Joseph went and craved the body of a man who was dead, as far as he knew, and not to return. That is service in love. That's a reflection of duty, giving honor to the body of a dead friend. And so he went out of risk to himself, and no care for that risk, and went and gave Jesus a decent burial, an act that needed to be done. The next morning, very early, women came to the tomb, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, and Salome, came to anoint that body out of duty and love, again, not knowing that Christ was risen. They went to do what was right. They went to do the work of anointing. They didn't know Jesus was risen. They had a love for Jesus that took them to the empty tomb to find it was empty. When they got there to anoint him, it was very early. It wasn't convenient to serve. It wasn't convenient to go there early in the morning. But they went out of love and devotion to await upon a dead man. Instead, they found angels telling them that the Lord had risen. And, well, I'm sure they were glad at that news. They were afraid. They were scared because they weren't expecting it to arise. Their love for Jesus was greater than having to know, like we do, that he rose. I wonder how great our love is for Jesus. We knew he arose. We know he arose. We live in that light. We just celebrated the great high of Pascha, the spiritual high of the resurrection. But now we go back to life. And are we craving the body of Jesus? Are we asking God how we can anoint him? How we can be in his presence? How we can honor him? How we can love one another? The women were amazed and afraid. And it says that they fled the place of service. They came there and they left afraid. Brothers and sisters, God has us operating in a place, in the state of Maine, the church located in Bangor and Brewer, Maine. He's given us gifts, spiritual gifts, each one of us. Are we doing those acts of love that keep that flame burning, even when we're not in a spiritual high? Are we serving God every day, day in and day out, in little things, in the role that God's given us? Duty and loyalty are not really popular. Duty and loyalty to Christ are absolutely necessary. For the body of Christ to be honored, we must crave it. We must crave him. You see, we operate today with a great advantage over Joseph of Arimathea and over the myrrh-bearing women. They came to anoint the body of Christ. They came craving the body of Christ. They came to be with Christ where he lay dead, as far as they knew. But we know he's risen. We live in the power of the Holy Spirit. We've seen the glory of the church. We've seen Christ with our spiritual eyes, our eyes from the dead. Do we serve like it? Do we do like the deacons did, waiting upon the women, the Hellenes? Do we serve God as we're able? Do we heed his high calling to be where he is, to continue to love him and serve him in ways that maybe no one sees? Loyalty, devotion, these are the things that keep love alive. When the fire of burning emotion attached to love doesn't exist. When all is discouragement and Christ is in the tomb, do we serve him? Just like we do when he's risen from the hospital. Do we love him in the quietness of our own homes when we love each other, when no one else sees? Do we visit, as James said, pure religion requires, the widows and the orphans and their affliction? Pure religion is doing these things out of duty, even when we don't feel like we should. Jesus said of the Jews that they made the commands of God of no effect. The command he was referring to was to honor your father and mother, one of the Ten Commandments, a very important command. And that honor was required, it wasn't optional. It wasn't to be done just when it was easy to do. It was to be done when it was hard to do. when the parents were sick, when they were afflicted, when they had nothing to offer back. And what the Jews did is, instead of honoring the way God asked them to, they said to themselves, it's Korban, whatsoever thou mayest be profited by us. What that means is that they said, it's a gift, what we give you. It's not duty. It's not our obligation. It's not our loyalty. It's just a gift because we're so generous. It's Korban. What God requires of us, my brothers and sisters, is to love him, not because it's a gift, but because it's right. It's duty. It's obligation. It's our responsibility to do both when it's easy and when it's hard. When we know a lot about Jesus Christ and we know just a little bit. When we know and feel like he's risen on the mountaintop, and when we're in the depths and we don't feel like he rose. My brothers and sisters, do we crave the body of Jesus Christ? That's the question we should ask ourselves. The body of Christ is here in our midst. The body of Christ is the church. And so as we serve here in this place, we get some idea of the measure of our real love for Christ. When we feel like it, or when we don't feel like it, we should be craving the body of Christ, continuing to love him and serve him. Whether the feeling is hot, or whether it's cold, whether it's great, or whether it's small, we should be craving the body of Jesus, craving serving him, and doing it because it's right, it's our duty, it's our obligation. May God bless us to do exactly that. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us say with